Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, you know, your favorite brother from another mother. Anyway, I thought I'd try something a little bit different today. I thought I would have someone who to come on here and kind of be a special guest, kind of help us to talk about the different YouTube rumors that go on YouTube and videos that people make. And I thought I'd have a special guest who might come on and talk. And so today's topic, I think that I was kind of debating what would be the first, what is the right word? False doctrine of the day. So let's start off with the first false doctrine. This one's a tough one. That's not so much fun. But it's, are we under the law or are we under grace? So anyway, I have a visitor today, and he's kind of shy, so he's just going to whisper in my ear, and then I'll say what he says. And here he is. Maybe some of you recognize him. He's kind of famous, and as a matter of fact, I met him in Chicago. You know, I do believe that he is from Chicago. So it worked out pretty good. And he's here with me, and Mr. Bozo. And Mr. Bozo was just telling me that he had seen videos on YouTube saying that Christians were under the law. We need to follow the law. And so that's why I asked Mr. Bozo to come on here and please tell us where he gets the idea that that we are under the law. So let me ask him. Let me see this. What's that? Because the Bible says that the law is for 10,000 generations. Well, you know, Bozo, the law was for the Israelites. It was not for the Gentiles. It's not for the Christian church. You don't, what's that? You don't believe me? Oh, let's look at the Bible. Let's look, brothers and sisters, at Acts chapter 15. You know, there's tons and tons of Bible verses. As an example, Paul has said, given at least 30 or 40 Bible verses that I can think of that tells us that we're not under the law, like Romans chapter 6. All of Galatians is about the fact that we're not under the law. What's that? Is that Bozo? Oh, Bozo said that Paul was from the devil, and Paul gave a different gospel than Jesus, and Paul shouldn't be part of the Bible. Oh, okay. So let's look at some other Bible verses besides what Paul says. But I want to say to you, and I want to say to Bozo, that if anybody starts telling you that they want to take out parts of the Bible, that they're rejecting part of the inerrancy, and if they don't know what the word inerrancy means, then they should not be given doctrine on YouTube. Big clue, inerrancy means, there's no errors in the Bible. So anyone that tries to tell you that parts of the Bible shouldn't be in there, that is a big warning sign. If you want to be a born-again Christian and not in a cult, you don't start taking out parts of the Bible that you don't want to receive. But all of it, of course, has to be divided. As the Bible says, as the Apostle Paul told Timothy, that you have to be a good, preacher or a good minister of the gospel and learn to, study to show thyself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. So number one, in that text, it's saying that, of course, you need to be a minister of the gospel to rightly divide the word. So there's nothing wrong with people proclaiming the gospel and witnessing and doing all those things. But we're talking about doctrinal dividing of the word. The Bible says in the New Testament, that teachers have to give a special account to God for whatever they say, whatever they teach. I've already made video many times warning those false prophets on YouTube that they have to give a special account to God for what they're doing. And obviously, if they think we have to follow the law, then they're not even born again anyway. They're not under grace, but they're under the law. Let's look at one old Bozo there, my friend, since you're so confused and you don't want to listen to Paul. Let's see what all the apostles and elders and the whole church, the original, Jewish church, who were all Jews, who had all been circumcised and all zealous for the law, just like the Apostle Paul, and he was there, Peter was there, and all those guys, all the disciples of Jesus, let's see what they had to say about it. Acts chapter 15. All those other Bible verses you can just go with this. This is the text of Peter and all the apostles were there. Let's see what it says. Acts chapter 15, starting at verse 1. And certain men that came down from Judea, that's where Jerusalem was, in Judea, taught the brethren and said, except you be circumcised. They're talking to the first Gentile church there. And they went there and they told them, except you be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you cannot be saved. So that's kind of contradictory to John 3:16. For God so loved the world, Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to whomsoever believeth in him, the Christ, the Messiah, Jesus, Yeshua, shall not perish but have everlasting life. Verse 2, when therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. Just FYI here, when it keeps talking about going up to Jerusalem, Jerusalem is like at 2,000 or 3,000 feet. You know, you're coming up from sea level down there, you know, coming from the coastal area along where the people travel. Over there, what is now, you know, the Gaza Strip or over toward that way, and then they would go up. You know, Jerusalem is a high area. So when you go there, you go up. That's why there's the Ascension Psalms, as people would go up to Jerusalem. Anyway, FYI there. Okay, for you too, bozo. Verse 3, and being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles, and caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they had come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and the elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. That's Paul and Barnabas. And there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees. It's always the Pharisees. They're not fair, you see. And the Sadducees, they don't believe in the resurrection, so they're Sadducee. And of course, the Pharisees were not fair. They thought they were better than everybody, just like a Nicodemus and those guys. They thought that they had some kind of a special right to go to heaven because of their birthright. And that's the problem with lots of these Gentiles who have tried to become Messianic Jews. They are trying to worship and idolize Jewish people. People put on a yarmulke and start throwing out a few Hebrew words. And next thing you know, people are idolizing them and hearing their words as if it have a greater power. When Jesus himself was born in a manger, God uses simple things to confound the wise. If you were to go back in time, if you watch any of these movies like The Passion of the Christ and all those movies, the Living Bible, you know, are this Matthew and John, you know, word for word movies, you can get the true vision here that the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all those guys and Herodians and all those guys were enemies of the cross. They rejected the Messiah and had him killed. As Jesus said, you know, he told Pontius Pilate, you know, these people that, you know, turned me over, they have a greater sin than you. Jesus said that the Jewish people, the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin who turned him over to Pontius Pilate had greater sin, Jesus said. Go read your Gospels. And so even today, if you go to Israel, they're going to start sticking their fingers in their ear and gnashing their teeth, just like in the book of Acts, with them when they stoned Stephen. And just like they did to Paul when he went back to Jerusalem toward the end of the book of Acts, like in Acts 20, 21, along in there. And they, even today, it's illegal to evangelize for Christ in Israel, and they will shout you down. They will get berserk, and they're ready to stone you. They're enemies of the cross. So stop all this worship of the law, worship of Israel, and worship the fulfillment of the law, Yeshua HaMashiach. That's why, what's that, bozo? What's that, bozo? Oh, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said that not a dash or a tittle of the law shall pass away, that all these things be fulfilled. Yes, he did say that, bozo, but did you read the verse before? He said, I didn't come to do the law, but to fulfill it. Jesus said, I came to fulfill the law in the verse before, bozo. And I believe that's in Matthew chapter 5, bozo. So, Jesus already fulfilled the law. He was without sin. And then he did what Adam failed to do. The law came, bringing death. Well, Romans, bozo, Romans tells the whole thing. Start at the beginning of Romans and read it through. It builds on that same topic. How that, you know, Adam, the first Adam, he disobeyed the one law. Don't eat the fruit of the tree. And then Jesus came as the second Adam. He fulfilled the commandments that God gave, whereas Adam failed. And then he went and died and took our sin and all that. He fulfilled the requirements of the law. Yes, the law has been fulfilled already through Christ, through the blood of Jesus, through the grace of God. Yes, it's called grace, bozo. Anyway, let's see. Let's keep reading here, bozo. Can you read? Let's look here. You know, the Bible says in James that the Bible is a mirror. Bozo, you are a clown. So in case you didn't know you're a clown, bozo, you don't believe you're a clown, here, look at the Bible. See, the Bible, in James, it says it's a mirror. So you look in the Bible, behold yourself in the mirror. Now, what do you see, bozo? Do you see that you're a clown now, judging yourself according to the Word of God? Let's see. Let's go on, bozo. You know Jesus loves you, and Jesus died for everybody, even clowns. Let's see. And when they had come to Jerusalem, they received of the church and the apostles and the elders, and declared all the things that God had done of them. Okay, verse 5, already read that. But there arose certain of the sects of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it is needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. And the apostles and the elders, verse 6, Acts 15, came together to consider all this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. That's Acts 10 and 11 at Cornelius' house, the centurion. Verse 8, And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost. There you go, brothers and sisters, all the people who deny the power of the Holy Spirit and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 10 and repeated in Acts chapter 11, we see that the Gentiles, Cornelius and all of his house, Peter knew and his disciples knew that the people had been filled with the Holy Spirit because they began to speak in tongues. The evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is speaking in tongues, just like in the day of Pentecost, then again in Cornelius' case, Acts chapter 10 and 11, his whole household, and then again in Ephesus in Acts chapter 19, and of course in Samaria. It doesn't say they spoke in tongues, but it said that when Simon saw that the Holy Spirit had been given through the laying on of the apostles' hands. See, so the Holy Spirit was given that he saw it. What did he see? He saw them speaking in tongues and prophesying. Let's keep going here. I'm sorry, Bozo, to get you confused with another topic. Yes, speaking in tongues is for today. Yes, the gifts of the Spirit for today. And speaking in tongues at the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not the gift of tongues, Bozo. Learn to divide the word. We'll have to do that one next time, Bozo. Okay, let's see. You know those people in Chicago. What can you do? I think Bozo's in Chicago. I can't remember. Let's see. And there was disputed Peter. Okay, we already read what Peter said. All right, he said that even as he did unto us, he gave them the Holy Spirit. Verse 8, is even unto us. Verse 9, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. What did Peter say? The same thing that Paul keeps talking about, what Jesus said. Jesus said, believe on me. In the Gospel of John, John says these things were written that you might believe that Jesus is the Son of God. So Peter says the same thing that Paul, people that don't want to receive Paul because it's so obvious, and he repeats over and over again about 20 or 30 times. Paul even says at the end of Galatians that he wished that those Pharisees who keep trying to tell the Gentiles they need to be circumcised would cut off, emasculate themselves, cut the whole thing off. Go read it. It's in the book of Galatians, written in plain, simple words. He wished he would cut the whole thing off, stop worried about being circumcised and trying to put it on the Gentiles. And see, so Peter says, and put no difference. God put no difference between us and them, the Jews and the Gentiles, purifying their hearts by faith, even as Paul says in Galatians. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by the law or by grace? Did you receive the gifts of the Spirit? Did you receive salvation by the law or by grace? Paul keeps asking him, oh, foolish Galatians, who's bewitched you? Of course, it's the Judaizers, always, just like the Judaizers today on YouTube, trying to yoke up and spy, as Paul said, spying out the liberty we have in Christ. Jesus said, those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. We're free from the law of sin and death. Let's see. Let's keep going there, Bozo. How you're getting it now, Bozo? You're starting to understand? Okay, hold on a minute, Bozo. Let's see. Verse 9, he put no difference. We already said that. Purifying the hearts by faith. And now, therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor us were able to bear? Of course they weren't able to bear it. That's why Jesus came. If people could be justified by the law, there would be no need for Jesus. You know, brothers and sisters, when I deal with Filipinos, who are 90% of Filipinos, are not. They're nominal Catholics. They just say they're Catholic because their family's Catholic. But every once in a while, you run into someone who is really a practicing Catholic and a hardcore idol worshiper, baby Jesus, the Black Nazarene, the Santo Niño, the Mama Mary. They're really into the idols so much. And I'll talk to them and I'll say, look, if you can be saved by all these works that you're doing, it's a different works than the law. Like the Jewish people are trying to follow the law and their own self-righteousness. And then you got, like the Catholics, like in the Philippines, they're trying to get into heaven by, you know, taking communion every day. They believe they're getting infusion of grace by going through the ceremony of the sacraments of the church. And then, you know, offering a food offering to the baby Jesus, the Santo Niño, or you know, going and rubbing the statue of the Black Nazarene. They have a big thing every year, a fiesta there in Manila, where people get trampled to death trying to touch the Black Nazarene to be healed, to be saved, and all this, you know, by works, a different kind of works, but still works. Now, therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor us were able to bear? So Peter is saying, look, none of us have been able to keep the law. No, duh. That's why Jesus came. Paul tells us in Galatians that the Bible, that the law of Moses, that wasn't in the beginning. Abraham was not under the law. Abraham was justified by faith, as it says in Genesis and in Paul reminds us this in Romans chapter 4. Abraham believed God that he would have a son and leave and go to the land I'll show you, and you'll have a son, and you'll be the father of many nations. And it says Abraham believed God by faith, and it was counted unto him as righteousness. So Abraham became righteous by faith long before the law was given. About 1,000 years later, 500 to 1,000 years later was the law given. About 700 years later, the law was given. Anyway, 500 years, whatever. Let's see. So verse 11, Acts 15, 11. But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they. Peter is talking. But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they. So Peter's not putting his faith in the law anymore. Can you understand that? That's why it's called the New Testament or the New Covenant. As God prophesied in the Old Testament, I'll write a new covenant with the house of Israel, or new covenant. A new covenant will I make. It's a new test. That's why we call it the New Testament. It's a new covenant. The law is what we call the Old Covenant, the Old Testament. But in there, of course, you have Genesis and the history and all that. That's not part of the law. The law begins when God gives the Ten Commandments to Moses and is for the descendants of Israel who came out of Egypt until the time of the Messiah. That was the season. And what does Paul tell us in Galatians? That the law is a schoolmaster to bring us to the knowledge of sin and death. So we can, when we look at all the mistakes and everything Israel did, God did that as an example. So we can see, as the Bible tells us, as an example, so we can see that by the deeds of the law, no flesh can be justified. We can never be perfect on our own because we have a sin nature. The only thing to remove that sin is the blood of Jesus, to be a propitiation for the judgment of God. Even as it says in John chapter 3, Jesus is talking when he talks about for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but ever have everlasting life. In that same chapter, back at the beginning, Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And then it goes on to say that whoever doesn't believe in Jesus, the wrath of God abides on him, or remains in modern English, King James, abide. The wrath of God remains on him. So the wrath of God remains on all people because of sin. This is a fallen world. We live in a fallen world. And then the only thing to block that is the King James calls it the propitiation. In other words, Jesus is over the, we get under the mercy seat. And Jesus, that's what all that stuff is, not a fulfillment, but a shadow of the coming Messiah, the mercy seat. The law is under the mercy seat. Sprinkling of the blood of Jesus, not the sprinkling of the blood of bulls and goats, but the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus is washing us clean of our sin. Not covering them as it happened in the Old Testament under the law, but in the New Covenant, our sins are washed away, never to be remembered no more, as God said he would do. Our sins are scarlet, but they become white as snow. By the blood of Jesus. By the blood of Jesus. Not by the deeds of the law. Not by anything we can do. So as soon as people start trying to say they're following the law, they're relying on their own self-righteousness. It's so simple. It's so simple to understand. It's by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by your works, so that no one can boast. And even as, and that's in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, but Paul tells us in Romans, when he talks about salvation, he said if you could earn your salvation, as if God owed you wages. Do you understand? God doesn't owe you pay. You didn't work for God and earn pay to be saved. But the when we do works after we're saved, as it goes on in Ephesians, after I said, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. It says we're not saved by works, but we're saved unto do good works. Also in Ephesians, just right in the same area, just right after that text, just a few more verses later. We're saved to do good works. And then our good works that we do after we're saved is our rewards in heaven. So easy, brothers and sisters, so easy to understand. Let me finish this text. I've been all over the place, and I always go longer than I thought I would. You know, but Bozo is distracting me with that, you know. I mean, look at him. He thinks he's ready to be, you know, the prophet. He thinks he's ready to be the bishop, Reverend Dr. Bishop Bozo. As a matter of fact, I think that's what I'm going to call him. The Right Reverend Dr. Bishop Bozo the Third, Esquire. Okay, let's see. All right, Bozo, I'm trying to help you out here because God loves everybody, even you. Let's see. Peter is talking, verse 11, Acts 15, verse 11, but we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. So Paul is like saying, or Peter is saying that, hey, we believe we're going to be saved by grace through faith, even just like the Gentiles are. What did he say? Verse 9 again, but put no difference between us and them. God put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why tempt God to try to put the yoke on the neck of the disciples, which neither we nor our fathers are able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they. Listen to what Peter's saying. Do you know these Judaizers, they can't. They're so full of doctrine, and maybe they're just like the Pharisees. Their ears are stopped up with darkness, and they can't understand. That they don't have ears to hear. Even as Paul said, you know, pray that God would open their eyes. You know, Satan has blinded people. Because it's a stumbling block. Even as Jesus said, you know, it's a stone that the builders rejected. It's become the capstone or the head of the corner, as it says in King James. Jesus is a stumbling block to those people trying to follow the law, to the Jews. It's a stumbling block that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever should believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. It's a stumbling block because Jesus told the Pharisees in John about chapter 8. He said, you read the law and you think you have eternal life, but you don't have eternal life from the law. Those scriptures speak about me, Jesus said. See, people get confused. People get confused, but it's not. It's a spiritual darkness over their eyes. I pray that it be lifted in Jesus' name. Let's keep going. And after that, let's see. So Peter said that, and neither our fathers able to bear it. We believe that they are saved even as they, by grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. Verse 12, and then all the multitude kept silent and gave audience to Barnabas and Paul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. And after they had held their peace, James, that's the half-brother Jesus, who wrote the book of James, we call it, okay, and his real name is, you know, Jacob. Let's see, the real reason why they used James is because they didn't want to confuse people about Jacob, the same name Jacob, from the Old Testament. James answered, saying, men and brethren, hearken unto me. And so James was the bishop in Jerusalem. He was the leader of the church in Jerusalem because the rest of them had went out into the world to win people. Simon, who's also Peter, Simon Peter, had declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles as Cornelius, Acts chapter 10 and 11, to take out of them a people for his name. And this agrees the word of the prophets as it is written. And I will return and will build again the tabernacle of David. That's the temple which is fallen down. And I will build again the ruins thereof and I will set it up, that the residue of men might seek after the Lord and all the Gentiles who upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord who doth all these things. Known unto God all his works from the beginning of the world. Wherefore my sentence is that, or therefore in the modern English, wherefore my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God, but that we write unto them that they abstain from the pollution of idols and from fornication, that's sex outside of marriage, includes all forms of sex outside of marriage, not only just, you know, what we would call, you know, adultery. Fornication is any sex other than marriage bed. Pollution of idols, that's idol worship, Catholic, and from things strangled and from blood. For Moses of old time hath in every city them preached to him, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. Then pleased it the apostles and elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch, that's the first Gentile church, Acts chapter 13, with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabbas, and Silas, chief among the brethren. And they wrote letters from them after this manner. The apostles and elders and brethren send greetings unto the brethren which are of the Gentiles in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia. So the whole leadership of the church, all the apostles and all those guys, wrote letters to the Gentiles. That's us, okay? For as much as we have heard that certain went out from us, troubling you with words, subverting your souls. See, people try to tell you how to follow the law. They're subverting your souls, brothers and sisters, saying, you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandments. Let me repeat that again. For as much as we have heard that certain went out from among us, troubling you with words, trying to subvert your soul, trying to send you to hell, trying to stop you from getting to heaven, saying you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commands. Can't make it much more simpler than that. It seemed good unto us, being assembled with one accord, and to send chosen men unto you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men that have hazarded their lives for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have sent them therefore Justus and Silas, who shall also tell you the same things by mouth, for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost, okay, that's God, and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. So people that even want to reject all the words of the apostles because they're hell-bent to be hell-bound from the gospel, even in the text God even put in here for our enjoyment, for our justification, for our absolute no excuse, where the half-brother of Jesus, James, a.k.a. also Jacob, says, for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost, that's God, and to us, all the leadership and all the people that walk with Christ on this earth, to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that you abstain from meats offered to idols, and from blood, and from things strangled, and from fornication, from which, if you keep yourselves, you shall do well. Fare ye well. So they went to Antioch and told the people. All right, Bozo, can you understand that? It's very simple. Even seemed good to the Holy Ghost, to God, that what the apostles told the Gentiles was that they did not have to keep the law. They didn't have to be circumcised. To abstain from things strangled, animals strangled, and from eating and drinking blood, and from fornication, and what else? Was there something else, too? I went saying it backwards. And from idols, food offered to idols. So can you understand that, Bozo? Is it getting through your head? Okay, brothers and sisters, I think Bozo is in agreement that he understands this topic, and he looks like he's excited about it. See? So next time, we'll discuss the rapture. Is the rapture real or not? Anyway, brothers and sisters, I went a whole lot longer than I thought it would be. You know, Bozo is very curious. As a matter of fact, I think one of the videos I need to do about his curiosity about, because he's told me he was also curious about becoming a homosexual, bisexual, something, or trisexual. I think that's what's wrong with Bozo. So we need to have a topic about that too. What does the Bible say about trisexuality? And he told me that he thought Bruce Jenner was pretty cool. And he's very curious. Maybe I should have named him Curious George too. But this is the Right Reverend Dr. Bishop Bozo III, Esquire III. And I thank him for his participation in helping us discuss the topic of, do Gentiles need to keep the law? God bless.